Hi, my name is Cory Miller. I'm the senior front-end developer at ConvertKit. I'm responsible for all of our marketing sites. Today, I want to talk to you about a project I spearheaded last year where we converted our WordPress site into being a headless CMS website, where WordPress is kind of the database, the content management system on the back end, and Next.js handling all of our front end, all while being the sole developer on the project. Oftentimes, developers might be on a team of engineers. Maybe you have a team or a squad. You also might be watching this as the only developer in your company or on your team, and maybe you see an opportunity for your website. So today, I want to talk about three things: getting your team on board, how to think through a rebuild architecture and process, and finally, how to get started on your own WordPress to Next.js rebuild. First thing I want to talk about is getting your team on board. No matter the size of the project, if you don't have buy-in from your team, it's going to be incredibly difficult to get anything off the ground, especially if you're going to be the only one who's working on the project. I had to communicate what we were lacking, I had to communicate what our options were, and I had to communicate what we would gain by completing this project and migrating from WordPress to this headless CMS using Next.js. We were lacking development, speed, and site performance, which was negatively impacting our projects and our SEO scores and overall conversion on the site, which is marketing site needs to have good conversion. Because of years of technical debt buildup, the builds for our site could take up to 35 minutes, which also meant the development time on projects was painfully slow. Dev tooling was poor, upkeep was painful, and trying to do anything without resorting to plugins like WordPress plugins, it was an absolute nightmare. It was terrible. Number two, what were our options? One, we could do nothing. We could just let it continue on. The second was we could fix what we currently had. We could rebuild how we used WordPress. We could continue to use that for generating our site. We could spend a pretty significant amount of time rebuilding how we use WordPress. And third, we could take that same amount of time and rebuild the site with a brand new architecture or framework. And then I had to communicate, well, what would we gain by pursuing this new project? Improved development time, which means we can move faster. We can get more projects and more updates out. It's going to give us improved SEO scores and performance, which means more traffic and decreased bounce rates, which ultimately means increased conversion, which is great for a marketing site. You need to bring facts to your team. You can't just say, hey, let's do this because it'll be better. Yeah, it'll be nice. It'll be fun. You have to make a case because there's a company and it's there to make a product. It's there to make a profit and be sustainable. And you have to help them understand why this is important. I had to get buy-in from most of the teams on the company since all of them interacted with the website in some way, shape, or form, whether that was content creation or using the site for migrations or sales. There was a lot of hands that kind of touched the website in different ways. If you could prove that the project will produce better results for your company, you'll be in a much better position to really make it happen. And these were the things I had to communicate to get buy-in from the team. Through several months of conversations and some testing, I started to get more and more people on board. And finally, we got approval to start what became known internally as Site 2.0. Once I had the support, I had to figure out kind of what was I gonna do to make the site rebuild work. Now, don't skip this. A lot of developers often, I think they just want to jump into the code, yarn, install, I want to NPX, create, I want to get everything down. Moving too fast without planning is the primary contributor to technical debt. Don't skip the planning. Start by researching the various technologies available. Then we also had to look at the site's requirements and document them. So document your site's requirements and various non-negotiables. In our case, I decided we wouldn't replace the CMS, but that the architecture of the new site should allow for moving away from WordPress in the future. You have to think about not just your current needs, but also your future needs. Will the new system support your growth in the next 2, 5, 10 years? Can you do it now so that you can grow as time goes on? The biggest piece of advice is don't reinvent the wheel. Stop. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. One of the best things that I did early on was to dive into a handful of open source repositories that were doing the same thing that I was doing. Namely, there was a great project by Colby Fayok from Space Jelly called Next WordPress Starter. It's a great open source little repository. It helped spark ideas, gave some great pointers on how to get started. The wheel already exists. There are a bunch of smart people on the internet who are doing the stuff you're doing. So once I had a rough idea, I prototyped a small section of our website using Next.js to see if it would actually work. This gave me an idea of performance and compatibility, brought up potential issues that we might run into. And doing this also gave me an idea of the timeline that we could expect that I could and you should bring back to your team. Now we can start writing some code. So finally, in this last section of today's talk, I want to talk about how we started the rebuild of our site in Next.js. For our site, we used a variety of great tools, obviously Next.js. Why else are we all here? We used a WordPress plugin called WP GraphQL, which uses the GraphQL querying language to retrieve data from WordPress. It's a fantastic way of getting only the data that you need. It's fantastic. We also use Apollo, which is a querying and state management library for fetching and handling data and state management for that particular data. There's a lot more that I can't get into today, but I started to kind of dial in what are the things that we're going to need that will help us scale and make this project happen. So the first phase was to break down the scope of work between WordPress pages and posts and a myriad of other content types. We had over 900 pieces of content that would need to be imported and handled by Next.js. The basic architecture I wanted to go for was to say, okay, we have Next.js, we've got pages, we've got posts, we've got everything in between, we've got guides, all these different content post types. What I need to do is we need to set up an architecture where I can create a page, I can request data, get data back somehow, and then create the page. We don't want to care about where the data is coming from. The page just needs to care about the data that it receives. It's a good idea to make sure that any changes that you need to make in the future require the least amount of edits in your code. So let's take a really, really quick example of one of the pages that may be the page that you make your posts with. In Next.js, we've got get static props. We're getting the params. We're taking the slug from the params that is created by the route. And we're saying, hey, I want you to use this resolved URL and get post by URI. What does get post by URI do? We have the Apollo client, which has a bunch of information stored in another folder. And we say, hey, use a query, get the post using this particular slug or this particular URI. This query is just simply a GraphQL query that says, taking the URI as an ID, return back the post content and database ID. Again, this is a very, very simple example. This is not exactly what's written in our code anymore. All we're saying is give me the post. And then also here in get post by URI, we have this function here that says take that data and create a post object from this query, from this data. And then that returns the data into this post object, returns it back to the page at the very beginning. And then that data is used to send on through and create the structure of the page using that data. In no place did I mention which CMS I'm using. I didn't even say how I wanted to fetch the data. On this page, I could now leave this and say, I want to go update, just get post by URI. I can just change where the Apollo client looks for data. As long as I'm returning that post object that's formatted correctly, the slug page, the post page, doesn't have to care about this. It just wants to know, did I get the data? Great. Is the data formatted correctly? Great. Now I can present it on the page. This sort of methodology changes it from being just like, I just give me the data, to give me data in a way that's abstracted away from the data source. There's something in the middle so that I can have the least amount of edits to make any changes in the future. Do the work now so that you don't have to later. So how long did this take? Well, it took about a year. That's a long time. But as the only person on the project, we had other projects going on. We had other campaigns and features that needed to be shipped. But then it was done. It took about 14 months. What's the payoff? Well, mobile scores, mobile SEO scores on Lighthouse increased from an average of 20 to 30 on Lighthouse to about an average of 75 now. There's lots of work to do there still, but we're in a better place. Site build time decreased from that 30 to 40 minute build time that I mentioned earlier to 2 minutes. Page and feature development time, it's seen a massive decrease in time and mental overhead. We can get something in, I can get a design, and we can have something ready by the end of the day, which has also meant that my own personal happiness and enjoyment with coding has increased by quite a lot. So in conclusion, don't be intimidated by the scale of the task. Focus on the value and the long-term benefits that it brings to your team, your company, and to you as a developer. Planning is crucial. Always plan and consider the immediate and future needs of your site and for your company. You don't need to reinvent everything. There's a vast community out there ready to help, plenty of free resources and valuable experiences that you can glean from. Seek stakeholder buy-in early and often. Ensure that your team understands the benefits and keep communicating as you progress. Thanks for coming to my talk. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. If you'd like to get in touch, I'm not really on social media all that much, but you can send me an email at cory@convertkit.com. I'd love to hear from you. Thanks again for watching and enjoy the rest of the conference.